Welcome back, Questers. One of my favorite students from the years I served the NPS. She returns today. You wouldn't think she would have been doing things like this if you'd known her in middle school. But she's really doing some big things with her life, and I'm so proud and I'm so happy. We have Miss Tajzee Strong, who is currently Miss Black Wisconsin, returning to give us an update on what's going on with her. And of course, if you've seen the first episode of this series I'm shooting with her called Tajzee Strong Back on Duty, she has re-enlisted into the military. And so we're checking on that and seeing what she's doing and how she's going in the military, and as far as also her endeavors to become Miss Black, Miss Black USA. So she's doing her thing, got a lot of other irons in the fire, and we'll be talking about that as well. So you are locked into the Quest with Roy Washington, and we will be talking with Miss Tajzee Strong. She's back on duty, y'all. Big ups.
Hi, so tired. All right,
why are you looking good?
Just make me look pretty and not sleepy or high.
Hi.
Everybody always tell me I look high when I'm sleepy.
Well, did you go out last night?
We just kind of did a little kickback at the house.
A little kickback? Yeah. Is hubby there?
Huh?
Hubby there?
No.
Oh, you got your friends that you've met already?
Yeah, I was hanging out with all the people that I know from the unit.
Okay, that's cool.
Oof.
Yeah. Now, was that on you on base, or you got your own off-post housing?
I'm at my house, off-post.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, do you like it?
It's in a decent neighborhood, so not too bad.
Okay. All right. So that's cool. You're in the backyard, I guess, or on the back porch? Or...
Yep. On my little back porch, listening to the squirrels hop around in the trees.
Okay. So I want to rewind a little bit. And first of all, congratulations. You're going to be going back, going for it again next year, right? 2020,
yes.
2022.
Yes.
All right. So, and you don't have to go through no pageant to keep your Miss Black Wisconsin?
I never had a successor, so nope. I just get to do it again.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Okay. So tell me what was it like when you hooked up with everybody else? You guys was going down there. Where you went to DC, right? Where?
Yes.
Where'd you
go? Was in Washington, D.C. for 5 days, I think.
Okay.
It wasn't bad. It was very weird, though, because there were, like, you would expect to see at least one girl from each state, but there really wasn't one girl from each state. A lot of people couldn't make it, or they had to drop out last minute because they got COVID.
Oh, wow.
So there was, like, a sporadic mixture of people that showed up. Like, there was a few from the East Coast, a few from the West Coast, and it was me in Illinois. I think we had a Minnesota, but she was for the misses, but not the, like, my division, you know? So it was weird because it was, like, a little bit of everybody from everywhere, but not in all of the divisions.
You said she was for the misses.
Yes. So there's the...
For miss.
The miss, which is what I do. And then there's the misses, which is... I think they're just like the married and like over a certain age range, have some degrees, something like that, you know. And then there's the teen, which is you're not married yet, but you also, you know, might not be an adult yet, or you're like, you know, late teenager, you know, age range.
Someone else you guys do?
Say again.
So the teens, what you guys do?
Yep.
Wow.
So my division, we did our own show, and then the misses and the teens did their show together. So, yeah.
And what did that show consist of?
Same thing. Literally the exact same categories as us. It was just with their people doing it. So they had the talent portion. They had the question and answer. They had the onstage fitness, onstage evening gown. And then the judges went and picked a person, and that's who won.
Okay, so for the talent, what did you do?
I didn't do a talent.
Okay.
Our division was so big that they ended up doing online preliminaries before we even got to DC. So then when we got to DC, they already knew who was doing the onstage performances, and I wasn't one of the people that was chosen. There was me and like one or two other girls that didn't qualify to do any of the onstage stuff, so I didn't actually get to do anything online or onstage.
Okay, so what did you get to do down there?
Meet people, take pictures.
That's it?
Take 5 days off army work. Yeah. That's pretty much cool. All I did.
That's cool. Because you know what that remind me of, though? That remind me of, you know, like, say, if you work in a job and they fire you or something, but they let you come to work anyway.
Yep.
Like, hold on. Why y'all didn't call me? Whatever. But if they... Yep. But when you put it that way, that you got a chance to experience it and make that travel and go out there for 5 days, that was cool.
Yeah. I mean, I won't lie. At first, I was a little upset about it because I was like, you know, I took a lot of time and effort and last minute paperwork and getting approvals by military people to come just to not even be able to, like, you know, compete. Like, it was aggravating. And then I thought about it. I was like, I just met the head of Fox Soul. Like, I don't care that all I got to do was stand here and be pretty. The guy who owns Fox Soul knows what my face looks like. Like, you know, wow. So...
That was cool. Why you didn't put those pictures on?
Huh?
Am I gonna get some of those pics?
I didn't take pictures with them.
No.
So I had a weird mindset about it. Like, I met the people that I could meet, but I didn't do like any photo ops or, you know, exchanging of like phone numbers or social media or anything like that, because I didn't want it to seem like I was taking away the opportunity from the girl who did win. So, you know, it was kind of like a word of mouth sort of meeting. And then after that, you know, if they remember me, they'll reach out. If not, oh well, sort of thing.
I seen the little video where you was getting on the bus and, you know, everybody said, hey, hey. So,
I turned him into a TikTok.
Oh, it did?
Yeah.
Yeah. So was that bus ride pretty cool? Did you you guys laugh and share stories? And was anybody that was really cool with you on that bus ride?
You would think so, but that was the bus ride leading up to competition, and we didn't know who was going to be able to do all of the stage competition yet. So everybody was just on the bus, like, making sure they got everything, and then they all secluded to themselves and started doing their prayers, and I was reading my book, and, you know, we was kind of just all to ourselves at that point. And then we got to the venue, and it was like, okay, come over here so I can help you do your hair, and you, I'm gonna need to help you with your makeup because you don't know how to get your lashes right, and I just gotta make sure you looking good. You can't go out there looking a mess. Like, yeah.
We started looking out for each other like that.
Huh?
At least I was looking out for each other like that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, the competition still was making sure the other girl looked good and whatever. Yeah, that's good.
Oh, yeah. My girl I roomed with, she was from Tennessee.
Okay.
Loved her because, listen, let me tell you, I have very natural Negro hair, okay? So when it comes to having stuff like this in, I don't know what to do with it. And every time we had to go somewhere, my roommate was like, no, come here. Come on, let me help you out. And she would come and do my hair for me every single day because I had no idea what to do with it. I was like, you know what? I'm just going to straighten it out and it's going to be what it's going to be.
Oh, man. Yeah. Did you guys hit a club or something down there?
Did we what?
Did y'all hit a club or something down there? Or?
They did the first night, but I was not with them because my flight got delayed multiple times in Dallas, and I got stuck in Dallas for like 6 hours.
Man, that's messed up.
Yeah. It was a very, very good time to experience. We'll just say like that. Thanks, American Airlines, for the discounted flights, but yeah. Stuck in Dallas for 6 hours, you know?
Okay, so, What are you gonna do next year that you learn, you know, that maybe differently for next year? What did you learn that's gonna help you go farther?
Absolutely,
you
know, nothing. Absolutely nothing.
You didn't learn anything that you're gonna do differently?
There's nothing I'm gonna do differently. Nope. I feel like I gave the best possible version of myself 1,000% of the time that I was doing my last reign, so there's no reason for me to change anything. If I get chosen this year, that's because, you know, the judges felt like I was who needed to be chosen this year. And if not, then that's perfectly fine. But I'm still there, you know, representing for a state that has notoriously been known not to love people of my skin color. So,
yeah,
you know, I'm doing the best that I can and I'm perfectly okay with that.
You know, when I served, one thing I heard a lot, you know, when I got to my duty station and all that was, I didn't know black people was in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
You know, I heard that a lot, you know. So, yeah, we're proud of you for what you did, you know. And like I said, we're going to be behind you again on the next one, you know. So hopefully we can go a little further or take it all, you know.
So are you know.
Right. Are you proud of you know, what you've done?
At first, I felt like I didn't do enough, right? Okay. I felt like I was slacking and there was more that I should have been able to do, right? But now I don't. Now I feel like I did great and I would love to do it again because now I'm out in Oklahoma representing Wisconsin in a national pageant. There's people internationally now who's watching me do this pageant because all of my friends from Korea are watching now. I've got friends in Dubai that's watching now. I got friends in India that's watching now. Like, you know, so at first I felt like I wasn't doing enough, but now I'm like, how many people can say that they just brought international attention to the state of Wisconsin?
Yeah. And it's so shocking. Somebody, I used to have to pull out of class once in a while and look at you.
I know, right?
Look at you now.
Look how far I've grown.
You've been to India?
No. I had some, I'll just say a group of students because it was some guys and some girls. I had a group of students my freshman year who came on an exchange program when I was going to McFarland High School. And I got really close with some of them. So we just kind of stayed connected over the years.
Okay. What's your favorite place that you've been to since you, you know, with your travels and all that? What's your favorite place you've been to?
Favorite place I've been? Probably South Korea, I won't lie.
South Korea?
South Korea, it's up there. I have yet to be anywhere that's past it.
What was it about South Korea?
The fact that the clubs never closed.
For real?
The clubs never closed. If they did, it was like between the hours of like 8 a.m. and 10 a.m., you know, like they never really closed.
You can still be in the club at like 7, 8 in the morning?
The time just kind of flies by. It's like you get sucked into a time warp and you can't even tell that you've been in the club for 7 hours. Dang. Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy, because you know, you think of it here, you know, like I say, it's 2 o'clock or 1 something, they start saying last call.
Yeah, no.
They're still going. Still
not
dancing.
Not in Korea. Not in Korea. The food still coming, the drink's still being poured, it's different shifts and waves of people entering and leaving the club.
So I imagine even the DJ, they probably get a relief, huh?
I don't know. I want to say the one time we actually paid attention to the DJ was probably when we were out there doing shows. Mm-hmm. Other than that, we never really paid attention.
Because they must make a lot if they did that long.
Yeah.
Looking at what DJs be making and stuff for you know, a few hours or whatever. But that's crazy. I think even Chicago, a place like Chicago, I think they close later than us, but I think they are. I've never known anyone to go like that.
Korea was a whole different breed.
Yeah. Have you got a chance to go out down there where you at? Where you stationed?
I went out once. Okay. I mean, there's not really much to do in Oklahoma, but, you know, I tried it.
It
a lot okay. of, I don't know how to describe it. You know all of the bars in downtown Milwaukee that aren't flooded with college students?
Yeah.
That's what all of the bars in Oklahoma are like.
Okay.
I don't know about Oklahoma City yet because I haven't been out there yet. And I haven't been out in Tulsa on purpose just because, you know, Black Wall Street, I'm not trying to go feel no pain. I'm good. Good on all that. Okay. But where I am... Yeah, I went out once, and I'll probably never do it again, because it was boring to me.
It was boring?
Yeah.
Hmm. Okay.
It's very small town, though, where I am. It's like going out in a town that's half the size of Racine, so
yeah.
I understand why, you know, they didn't really have much to do, but I was like, dang, y'all got some young people that live here, you know, get something going.
Yeah, I'm surprised, but and then you know what? It's always a small town. I've seen outside of a base like at Fort Hood. We had Killeen, Texas. That's right outside the base, and I forgot which outside of Fort Knox. I forgot what city that was. A little city that was Elizabethtown, D Town.
I tell you,
I think it was Elizabethtown or something. But they're not that. Usually the clubs is kind of hopping because of the military people, you know.
That's what you would think, but I see like a lot of people that I'm stationed with out here, they'll just go to Oklahoma City or they'll drive to Dallas for the weekend because, you know, they're basically the same distance away, and most of them will just be out there in one of those locations and come back to work on Monday like nothing happened.
Oh, the Dallas, Texas?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so, have you, well, first of all, so now you come back to, you know, to duty and everything. Are you still getting that little celebrity kind of status, or are you kind of hearing jokes about your, you know, when people just kind of bigging you up, just joking with you about your pageantry?
Nope, it is still a big thing. I've got some things in the works on this end that I'm trying to make happen for my line of military people. That's all I'm going to say about it. I don't want to go too much into detail in case it don't happen. But all I'm saying is if you got some celebrities you want to have do some performances, hook me up and let me know. Yeah, oh, really? there's a lot of people that are still really excited about me doing all this because I keep getting to do like Army newspaper interviews, or you know, they're doing like blog spots on me and stuff, and it's bringing attention to the unit, and it's bringing attention to the post, and you know, bringing attention to the Army. So everybody is just like really excited. Every day I meet somebody new that's either seen a story or seen a video or like, you know, read something and was like, aren't you the girl over there in HHB that's doing the pageant? Every day.
Yeah, you know, if I was your CO, I'd be taking full advantage.
Everybody said they're confused because I still go to work every day, and they're like, I wonder why like your unit doesn't just like send you around to go talk to people. And I was like, because they got to get work done, you know?
Right. Just here. So, yeah, because I know my CO, he took advantage when I met my guy from New York, Tony Bartley. He, you know, he was a rapper, and I was just starting out. He took full advantage of that. We did shows, we did all kinds of stuff. So I imagine, like I said, if I was your CEO, you'd really be doing some stuff, you know.
Well, I have a feeling that there will be some opportunities like that, especially once it starts to come out into light, the few things that I'm working on now.
That's cool.
But until that happens, you know, I still gotta make sure the soldier side of me is together. Oh, yeah. So, you know. Got to keep up with the PT and got to get healthy and, you know, pass all the qualifications and all that good stuff. So I'll be doing that alongside of all the pageant stuff while also getting ready to go back to college. So
how are those morning runs?
I don't know. I don't get to do them.
You don't get to do PT?
No running.
Are you injured right now?
I'm previously injured from the last time I was in the Army. I have a knee injury. And I tried to take the PT test a couple of weeks ago, and it ended up injuring the rest of my leg. So now I'm injured from the knee down to the tip of my toes on my right leg. So I just been working on getting that back together so I can go back to doing physical therapy for my knee. And hopefully, before I leave Fort Sill, I'll be able to run again. I won't have to keep walking or doing the bike.
Okay. You're not wearing no cast or nothing, though, right?
No cast. I wrap up my leg every once in a while. I have two different knee braces that I wear, and then, you know, elevation, and then swap between ice and then heating the knee. So,
oh, sorry to hear that.
That's okay. You know, it comes with the job.
You still got the
war pain? Job? Never hurt nobody.
Yeah. So what about on the job when after formation and all that? You know, what's that like? What's your day like on the job?
I really don't do much of anything yet. Right now, I'm studying to pass qualification tests. Yep, there's some behind the scenes things that still need to be done before I can fully get into my job right now. So while that's taking its time to be processed, I'm just studying so I can get qualifications and certifications. And, you know, by the time I'm able to actually do my job, I'll be really put together and a really big asset. So
okay, so you seem like you're just kind of chilling right now then.
You would think so, but my brain is on fire. everybody always comes into the office and they're like, man, Strong, you don't ever do nothing, you always just be in that chair on your laptop. And I'd be like, they'll walk in the office and I'm just in the middle of doing this because I'm reading and studying and my brain is just fried every day. I do it for 8 hours a day. I sit in a chair and I study and I take tests and I study and headache.
Okay. That's not your dog, is it?
No. I haven't got my dog yet.
Oh, you gonna buy one or you got one coming from home?
No, I'm gonna probably buy one if I can't find one to rescue. I want a German Shepherd puppy.
Okay. You got a backyard big enough for him?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah? You should give us a little tour.
You know, I would, but you know, OPSEC. Gotta be safe. Can't let y'all know about any landmarkers to come and find me, you know?
Look at you. Look at you. Okay. Yeah. Somebody might be watching or something. You know, you ever seen Red Skull?
Yeah.
He was G.I. Joe's arch enemy, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, he might have you on his hit list or something.
You never know. I could have me a super fan out there who's going to fly to Oklahoma and get me.
Oh, man. You haven't experienced nothing like that. You haven't experienced a real aggressive guy at the little club or like we talked before, you haven't experienced no aggressive guy in the company or the unit yet?
Not out here. I think everybody kind of just knew not to go there with me. Once they found out I was prior service and why I got released from the Army the last time, they kind of just knew.
Which was BS.
No, nobody really bothers me now. It's more of I think they kind of use me more of like a mentor now. Because they asked me a lot of questions about, like, you know, my last time in and what different experiences were like and what I've learned and, you know, how I would do stuff. So it kind of feels more like I'm big sister to all these little babies now. So I'm okay with
that's
that.
That's cool.
Yeah. Especially because most of them were born in the year 2000 or 2000 and. So, you know, yeah, I feel a little old.
You're your mama.
Feel a little old. One kid told me he was born in 2001. I was like, 2001? Like 2001? Like 2001? He was like, mm-hmm. I was like, cool, so I feel old.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah, so you see the reversals, the roles reverse now. See, how does it feel?
You know, I think I look real good to feel this old. That's all I'm going to say.
And it's good though that you might have a young female soldier or something that you can kind of tell her what you went through and maybe she don't have to go through that, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or even a guy soldier. I mean, it could happen like that too.
It's been me giving advice to a lot of guys lately. I'm the only female in my section. So I work with all guys and 99.9% of them are young and immature, so, you know.
Okay.
If I gotta be mama to the section, I'm gonna have to be mama to the section, because, you know, I can't have my section out there looking busted.
So, nobody's coming to formation, kind of like maybe a little hungover, feeling a little too nice, and uniform might be a little, you know, less than desired.
Even if they are, you will never hear me admit it.
Yeah, but if you do see that, you kind of gonna kind of straighten them out.
Oh, fix it.
Yeah, because you about to be sergeant now, aren't you? Aren't you up for?
That is the next rank. Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So what type of sergeant are you gonna be?
I apologize to every single PAO guy that's gonna see this interview, but it will not be a sergeant that the Army would like.
What that mean?
I don't plan to be the type of NCO that is very by the book and only cares about making Big Army happy. I feel like the way that we keep Big Army happy is to make sure that our soldiers are happy and taken care of and understand what it is that they're supposed to be doing and why they're supposed to be doing it. So if it means that I get in a lot of trouble for breaking all of the Big Army rules to make sure that my soldiers are taken care of, then so be it.
I don't know if I've ever told you the story, but you know, that's how I got promoted, because I was kind of like that. We had some cool sergeants and stuff, but we also had a couple sergeants who was kind of soft and who, just to make whoever happy would let their men, you know, just be in all kind of crazy situations.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I had he was a sergeant major. Sergeant Humes had us doing a detail or something. I was a specialist, and me and some of the guys, we're out there, you know, because we drive those fuel tankers, those 5,000 gallon tankers, and we're out there pounding stakes into the cement, because you know the tankers got to be grounded, you know, and other guys that was supposed to be helping us, Humes got them over there. They chilling. kicking back, and we doing this hard work. And I told him, hey, these guys got to come over here and give us a hand, you know. All right. Your hands start ringing after a while, you know, just feel the vibration in your hands. And he was just kind of like shooing me off, like, no, y'all going to take care of that or whatever. And we had a confrontation. I told him, no, my men ain't going to do that. Not, you know, if they supposed to be helping, they're going to come over and help as well. And so I'm going back and forth with him, and he, get that attention or whatever. You know, when you get that attention, you know, it's supposed to be over with. I'm like, no, I'm not. You know what I'm saying? So we had that standoff, and I think he respected that because maybe 3-4 months later, when the promotion came up, he was big time for me to get it. Because I guess he knew that what kind of leader I'd be.
Yeah. You know?
And so I guess I see that in you as well. So that's very respectful. Because you didn't, your people know that you're going to go all the way for them. They'll do anything for you.
I know that it's not gonna be a smooth transition, you know, because it's basically like I'm saying I'm gonna go against the grain on everything. So, you know, I already know that I'm gonna be in a lot of trouble a lot of the time, but my soldiers are always gonna be taken care of. So, you know.
And somewhere somebody high up will see that and make sure that you're good. Trust me. Somebody's gonna make sure that you're good. So don't worry about it. That's kind of the way I was as a safety, as a security.
Yeah.
You know, there was a lot of security just wanted you to get out of the halls. And, you know, I mean, a lot of stuff. But, you know, I guess I was the one who you could come to if you had a problem. A lot of people came to me because they had problems. It was, whether it was hungry, whatever, I always went out of my way. So, and that didn't really go over well with some of the other securities, too. Not all the time. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I care for people. And so, like I said, somebody's always going to make sure you're good. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about the hate. Somebody's always going to make sure you're good. All right? All right, God, put that in your heart, you know, just ride it out and just be that person. You know what I'm saying? So I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
What else you want to share with us? Because you got all this secretive stuff going on. We'll find out, though.
Honestly, there's not really much else I can say right now.
Yeah.
I got a whole lot of top secrets happening, you know? That's as far as I'm at right now.
A lot of top secrets.
What I will say... Yeah, I can say that. Let's just say I've been in communication with Chris Massey. There's people who don't know who he is. There was a show called Zoe 101 back in the day. He played the black character. That'll help you figure out who he is. So I've been in communication with Chris Massey, and I've been sending out a few more emails trying to get in contact with some managers and band reps and things like that. And this year will be a fun experience. That's all I can say.
The band reps.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
This year has a lot to offer.
So we're going to just have to fire Google up a little bit.
See what you can figure out. Yep, get some sleuthing in.
The sleuthing in, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let me just throw this out here. Let me ask you this. Have you ever, because you got a beautiful voice too, have you ever sang or wanted to eat some music or something?
I do. I write my own lyrics and...
Rapping?
No, I sing. I was doing like beat production for a little while, just trying to tinker with it and figure out how to do it. But I found that it's a lot easier for me if I just find a beat that's already made that I like and I can just write lyrics to it. So I've written a few of my own songs, and I started a studio with a friend of mine that I met over in Korea.
You started a studio?
Yep, we were both in the army together. And then we kind of went, put a pause on it after we, basically we started our studio in Korea. We got a group of artists together. We did a music video. We used to go do concerts and stuff out in Korea. And we were going to come back and open it stateside somewhere down in Texas. But then he started doing army contractor work. And now he's over in United Emirates. So he's over there, and then I'm back in the Army, so we're gonna take a break on that and just kind of keep like developing music for now until both of us are like stable, and then we're gonna go open the physical studio. But where, yeah,
is some of that stuff on YouTube somewhere, or where can we find it?
You can Google my name and find it on YouTube and Facebook.
Yeah. Okay.
All of the music that I have on Apple Music isn't out yet for y'all to see, because I'm actually working on an EP of my own, so it's not accessible yet.
Oh, okay. And how far are you on your EP? Because an EP is maybe, what, 5 or 6 songs?
Yep. I want it to be 5, and I have 3 already. Yeah, so I just need to do 2 more that I'm comfortable with and add them on there, and then have my guy go over them and spruce them up, because I can't do any of the studio side stuff, and then it'll be accessible.
How can you keep that from me, though? That's I mean, you was in my video. I mean, what's going on?
I kept it from everybody. Because I officially retired from singing back in like 2016, so...
But what made you get back into it?
You ever been born with one of those little hidden talents that you feel like it's just something you can't get away from? Like there's a reason that you were born with that talent?
Okay.
That's me when it comes to singing. My entire dad's side of the family sings. And you know me, I've always been into instruments. I play the drums, I play violin. Like, I've always been playing something, teaching myself how to play guitar, teaching myself how to play piano. But I've always been a singer.
Okay.
Always. Like, every time I try to quit, I end up in a choir class. So I just started writing my own music.
So, with me going back into my new EP right now, if I have a song y'all want you to get on, would you sing a hook?
It depends.
On what?
If the song matches my voice and what I stand for.
I'm sure, man. I'm sure it probably matches what you stand for.
I don't know. You have to let me listen and let me choose.
Yeah. A song like Secure the Hatch, would that match what you stand for?
Yes.
Okay. You know, I don't know. You know, I don't stray too far from that type of message.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm eager to hear this EP. And I'm eager to hear it when it drops.
Yeah, I know a lot of people that's been waiting.
Yeah. Yeah, because I'm trying to figure out who you would sound like and think about all these singers who you would kind of resemble, because you got the deeper voice. So.
I can't really match it. My voice is like my music taste. It's very eclectic. My talking voice is very low, but I can sing very low and very high, and
I can
do country
too.
Well, I can do rock well, I can do R&B well, so like it's really hard to say who I would sound like, because you can basically pick somebody from each genre and be like, you got a little bit of her in you.
You got a little T-Boz in you?
There are some I can hit some T-Boz levels on.
Yeah?
Yeah. Hmm. My voice isn't, I don't even think that my voice is very unique to me. Because there's so many different artists that I can sound like. Like, I couldn't pick out my voice for you. If you played, like, my voice in a background track with a whole bunch of other artists, I couldn't tell you which one was mine.
Really?
Yeah. My voice is that weird.
So judging from how you sound when you speak, you really couldn't tell if you were singing.
Oh, no. You could tell that I was singing, but it would confuse you when you hear how I sing versus how I talk. Like, you remember when Adele first came out and everybody heard her voice and they were like, oh my God, it's so soulful and so powerful. And then she started speaking and she had this like really thick accent, yeah, and everybody was confused.
Yeah.
That's kind of how I am. You hear me singing, you're like, oh my God, it's so nice and light and airy. And then I start talking and you're like, who upset her? What happened? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're looking forward to that. And I'm sure maybe there's some acting going on too. I'm just picking because now you got me just curious. But I'm sure there's probably some acting or something small, maybe a little acting thing or something. But I believe so.
I had some acting opportunities this past year, but then I re-enlisted, so all of that's kind of being put on the back burner right now.
Yeah. Don't worry, I'm not gonna tell the Red Skull. I'm not gonna tell him that.
Okay. They can try to find me. They never will.
Somewhere in a bunker or somewhere in Oklahoma.
You never know.
You're not worried about tornadoes, are you?
I'm from Wisconsin. What I got to be worried about? We get tornadoes up there.
Not in Milwaukee.
We get tornadoes.
Not in Milwaukee.
Not in the city of Milwaukee, but Milwaukee County gets them. Mm-hmm.
We had a close call 2-3 months ago.
Y'all got a close call, and then about 45-minute to an hour drive northwest or northeast of y'all, they actually got hit.
Yeah, I'm going to be up northern Wisconsin next month for a paranormal type case.
Nice. So
you might want to check that out. So, but anyway, thank you for letting us be updated and see what you're doing.
Anytime.
I hope the next time you'll be able to give us a little bit more and maybe be able to tell us a little bit more about some other stuff.
Hopefully.
Yeah, so you enjoy the rest of your day. And just enjoy yourself and have fun and go ahead and get all that knowledge you got to get so you can pass everything that you're trying to pass and, go on with your career. Have a great career.
You know, I'm going to do my best. PhD on the way.
Yeah, I say around November we'll be checking back with you again.
Hey, birthday month.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Okay.
My birthday is the last day of November.
And how old would you be? The last day of November?
Yep, November 30th.
Man. How old would you be?
24.
24.
Mm-hmm. Seems like I'm so much older, right?
Yeah, just your presence. I guess what you've been through. Stuff you've been through. You just got that demeanor that, you think that you're... Of course, you don't look like you're much older, but, you got that demeanor like you are at least in your 30s or close to 40 or something because you just got that demeanor. Because you've been through so much, but that's good.
Yeah, I've lived double my lifetime in half the time.
Yeah, maybe so. You have, but, like I said, we'd be proud of what you've done and what you are doing. And now you got to be excited about this music. So once you put it out, you got to come on and rep it on Quest.
You got it.
Once it drops.
I'll let you have a couple.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to that. Because, I love music, man. I never seen that one coming. You kind of caught me with the little hook shot on that one. I didn't see that one coming.
See? Told you. I always got something hidden up my sleeve.
Yeah, you had
just that. It's like me writing this novel nobody knew about.
Writing a novel?
I'm writing a book.
About your life?
Nope.
Is it fiction?
I am writing a YA fantasy novel. The easiest way to describe that genre would be like the Harry Potter books or the Twilight books or stuff like that. Okay. Yeah.
Well, what's going to be more like Twilight or Harry Potter or something in between?
So my book is basically like if you take a little bit of X-Men and a little bit of Star Wars, a little bit of Harry Potter, and I won't say Twilight because it's more along the lines of like old school vampire stylish. So like maybe like Blade, you know, Dracula type stories, and blended them all together. Yeah.
Man, so you got so much going on, man.
Yeah. But the way I got it written, like it's basically like the easiest way to explain it would be, so you know how like we'll watch movies and be like, man, you know, I think I would make a real good X-Men. You know, like they made me somebody sort of like Wolverine. Like, you know, that's basically how it is. The book starts off in, I think I placed it in like LA or something, you know. So like it starts off in the US, you know, our world, our country. And by, I want to say it's like by the third chapter, where somewhere else in the galaxy, the girl had been kidnapped and she'd been experimented on, and now she got all these different things she can do, and yeah, whole different life that she can't remember.
Yeah. She's a badass.
Yep.
That's you.
Basically, the beginning of my story kind of starts off like Captain Marvel.
Okay.
Remember how Captain Marvel kind of started and it was like that, you know, two different things happen. Yeah. That's basically how it starts off. But then there's, you know, it goes into, like, how that planet got to the stage it was at, like, you know, the previous war and all that good stuff. And, you know, my main character is a black chick. You know, she got to be a black chick, you know. Shoot. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Maybe you're starring your own film.
Maybe. Maybe.
Okay.
But if not, you know. Look, if not, I'm okay with a long list of people to play me, you know.
That sounds interesting, though. So, how far along are you?
So, I've actually written the entire book already. Yeah, I'm just going through it now and filling in any plot holes I think I might have, or, you know, adding a little more detail where there can be, so that, you know, the book gets a little bigger and it actually feels like a book and not like a short story. So, yeah. That's what's taking the longest. It's basically like, this is like my fourth time editing the book.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So hopefully we can look forward to that being published next year sometime.
I'm hoping.
You're hoping?
I mean, I've had, I think it was three, maybe it was either two or three publishing companies that reached out to me already. When I sent out like a rough draft of the short story version. So I had like two or three of them email me back and was like, yeah, whenever you feel like you're ready, just send us over the manuscript. And, you know, so I could be a published author sometime soon. So I'm hoping.
You clowning. Have you ever kind of sketched out what the star looked like? The star of the series?
She has a description in the book. But the way that I saw her when I was writing the description, very average, like, you know, very average body build, average height, average size. But, you know, she's like every black woman you ever saw back in the 70s or back in the 80s. Like, skin is just the perfect shade of cocoa, you know. Her hair is either really crazy afro or it's kind of laid down wavy, you know, depending on what it wants to do that day. And she's just gorgeous to everybody, just beautiful. That's the way I saw it. And I only did it that way because, you know, in the very cocky high hopes that my book gets turned into a movie, I don't want it to be said that, you know, there was some actress that wanted a trial for the lead role and she couldn't because it's specific that, you know, this actress has to be 5'7" and she's only 5'2", because I've run into that a lot. Like, there's been a lot of stuff that people have tried to get me to audition for and I can't because my boobs aren't big enough or my waist isn't small enough or, you know, I'm two shades darker than what they, you know, wrote for the character description. I don't want that. And I also put in, there's somebody in my book for everybody. There's white characters, there's Asian characters, there's Mexican characters, there's guys, there's girls, there's trans. There's somebody for everybody in that book on purpose.
Mm. Wow. So that's something else we can't wait for then.
Yep.
And you said that, though, I was going to ask you, you reminded me of a question I had. Are there any trans serving with you?
I don't know. I don't know. You know, we're in a whole new era now, you know, and.
But you would, but I would think that, I mean, everybody would have to know who everyone is, you know, even if you know.
Nope. Not our business to know. If it it's just like, so happens that, you know, I get into a relationship with a guy or something, right? Say we're out here, we're talking, we get into a nice relationship and he tells me, oh, you know, I was born a woman. Cool. Then that's around that time where, you know, it would be your choice or, you know, y'all's choice to handle that however y'all handle that. But like if there's just, you know, someone in the unit that's trans, they don't have to come out and tell everybody that they're trans, you know. So honestly, I couldn't tell you, but I take that more to the positive side because it lets me know that if there are people in my unit that's trans, that I'm not working with a bunch of homophobic assholes.
Right.
You know, because nobody's been hurt yet. Nobody's been, you know, bullied about it or picked on or, you know, thrown under the bus. So I think that's I think that that's positive because the last unit I was in wasn't like that.
Right. Last unit you was in was kind of a mess.
Yeah.
I was recently reading this article. There was a you follow MMA, right? Or at least you know what MMA is. So
I know what it is.
Octagon. And there was this trans woman who used to be a man fighting. Just your opinion. Do you think it's fair for a trans woman to be fighting in the women's division? Because naturally, she'll probably still have that natural man physical strength over a natural woman. Or do you think they should have a trans, division? Or let her fight against the women, or let her fight against men, or just have a trans division?
There's a lot of people that get upset with me when I give this answer, but I feel like it's okay. If you are identifying as a woman and you know you've done your transition and you are a woman now and you want to compete in my division, come on. Because I know that you're taking, you know, the hormones that need to be taken for you to produce what we produce, and you know, like your body chemically is of a woman. You still have some leftover man in you, but your body is of a woman, right? So even if you have a little more testosterone, that's fine, because you got to think about how many natural born women we have taking care of natural born men with no issues, you know. So I feel like, hey, you want to be in my division, then come right along and help me find out how strong I am.
Says the woman who left the man a little beat up in the elevator. She backed away.
You know it. You know it.
Badass. Love it. All right, so we're going to go ahead and say goodbye to you right now. And like I said, we'll be touching base with you again in November. Looking forward to that one. I'm probably gonna try to get it close to your birthday.
Okay, we can do that.
Yeah. So hold on a second. Say goodbye to my people. Say goodbye to the sisters.
Hello, everyone out there watching. Thank you for tuning in to the Quest Nation radio station today and watching my interview. This is Tajzee Strong, your Miss Black Wisconsin 2020 and 2022. Saying goodbye.
Goodbye. Hey, thank you very much. Take care of yourself and have a great time out there. If you can send me, you already said if you can send me them selfies now, so I can start implementing them. And try to send me that other stuff by the time you go to bed.
Okay.
You got it. And try to get it on. Did any of your fellow soldiers see your other interview?
They have been Google freaking searching me since they found out I was doing pageants. They found everything. They found your video. They found my videos from Korea. They found everything. Yes.
Oh, so okay, because I noticed this, so the numbers was up in there. Okay.
They found everything.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Miss Celebrity.
Yeah, you know I do what I can.
Don't hurt nobody down there. Now. If you run into somebody that you can't handle, call me. I'll come down and take care of
you. You got it.
All right, you take care of. Send me that stuff, though, okay?
I will.
Bye bye now.